Hi children, welcome to the third session of this chapter, Solution. In the last two sessions, we already discussed about what are solutions and different types of solutions, then different methods to express the concentration and few numericals we did as part of the session. Now, today in this third session, I will be discussing the solubility and Henry's law. Okay, come, let us start. Solubility, what do you mean by solubility? So you know, if I ask you to prepare one glass of lemon juice to me, so what you will do, you will take one glass of water, right? To that you will add that lemon juice, that is you squeeze that lemon, then for taste you either add sugar or you can add salt. Choice is yours, right? Okay. So, how much amount of sugar you can add? Can you add infinite quantity of sugar? No. You will add according to your choice, your taste, right? If you add one spoon, you find it, okay, I want little more. What you will do? You will add one more spoon. Again, you thought, okay, I want little more. So, what you will do? You will further add one more spoon. So, if you think, okay, I want to have more sugar, more sweeter, if you keep adding, do you think nature permits you to continue as per your wish? No, right? Why? Yes, after some time, you will end up with a stage where you won't be able to add much more sugar into it, because whatever sugar you add thereafter will remain insoluble. Isn't it? Right? So, this is about what we are going to discuss today, that is the solubility. You know, a substance dissolves in another substance, say a solute dissolves in a solvent, right? And the extent to which a solvent permits the solute to go into it is what we call it as its solubility. Whose solubility? The solute solubility. So, when you add a particular solute to a solvent, a specified amount of solvent, what happens? You can add to a particular limit. That is the maximum amount you can add to that particular quantity of solvent at that particular temperature. So, actually, how can you define solubility? So, we can define solubility as the solubility of a substance is its maximum amount that can be dissolved in a specified amount of solvent at a specific temperature. So, what is it? It is the maximum amount of a solute that can be dissolved in a specified amount of, specified amount of solvent at a particular temperature or a specific temperature. So, here we have to look at two, three things. What is the maximum amount, first thing. Second thing, that can be dissolved in a specified amount of solvent, that is another very important thing. And the third one, at a specified temperature. Why I specifically mention these three terms means, it will be varying, right? So, we will be looking at the factors that affect the solubility of a solute in a particular solvent. Okay. Now, so what are the various factors upon which this depends? So, first thing is nature of a, what is the first thing? Nature of solute and solvent. First one is nature of solute and solvent. Second thing is the temperature, very important factor, temperature. And the third one is the pressure. What is the third one? Pressure. Okay. So, we will be discussing on these three aspects one by one. Now, coming to the solubility of a solid in a liquid, okay, we are first going to discuss about the solubility of a solid in a liquid. You know, there is a general rule which we can say, like dissolves like. What is it? Like dissolves like. What does it mean? Like dissolves like is very simple. You are familiar with polar solvents prefer to dissolve which one? Polar solute. And non-polar solvents prefer to dissolve where? Which one? Non-polar solute. Simple example I will tell you. You have sugar, right? Sugar is easily soluble in water, right? But you try to dissolve it in carbon disulfide. So do you think in oil, will it dissolve readily in oil? But it readily dissolves in water, because sugar contains slightly polar molecules in it, and these polar molecules get easily interacted with or attracted with by the water molecule, which is also polar in nature. And you know camphor, right? Camphor, it is a non-polar solute. If you try to dissolve it in water, nothing will happen. Similar is the case with naphthalene. You might have seen naphthalene balls used in what? Washrooms, right? So that is the it is insoluble. It is not soluble in water. So here, first thing that we are going to look at is the solubility of solid solute in a solvent, right? Now here I took the case of a sodium chloride. What is it? Sodium chloride, you know, it is a typical ionic compound. So when you add sodium and chlorine, for example, you take Na plus ions and Cl minus ion, they are combined together to form a crystal lattice, right? In crystal lattice, you have a cluster of sodium and chloride ions arranged in a octahedral manner, right? So when you put the sodium chloride in water, first of all, what should happen? The sodium and chlorine, it should split and come out, leave the lattice and come out. And energy required that process is what we call it as lattice enthalpy, delta H lattice, right? So you can write this splits to form, okay, it forms sodium chloride lattice. I can just simply represent it like this. So many sodium and chlorine ions are arranged in the solid. Now when this sodium chloride solid, when you put it in water, it splits and form separate sodium ions and the chloride ion, okay, it comes out sodium ions and chloride ions, right? This process involves certain energy, it requires some energy. What is that energy term called? Delta H lattice, okay, enthalpy of lattice, that is lattice enthalpy. So once the sodium and chloride ion gets splitted out, where it is coming? See, Na plus and Cl minus, where it is coming? It is coming into the water medium, right? So what happens then? You have water, HOH, you know, it is a polar molecule, oxygen is partly negative and hydrogen is partly positive. So this negative oxygen try to come and surround this Na plus. So you have HOH water, this oxygen surrounding whom? This sodium. So you can expect almost 6 water molecule coming around whom? This sodium, right? And thereby it forms a covering of water around sodium ion, and that process is what we call it as, tell what is that process called? Yeah, that process is called a solvation. What is it? Solvation. If the solvent is water, specifically you call it as, right, hydration, okay. So hydration, this is the case with sodium ion. The same can happen with chloride ion. What is the charge of chloride ion? Cl minus, right? So which ion can come, or which atom can come around it? So you can have hydrogen forming, hydrogen come and make bond, okay, because hydrogen is partly positive. Like this, they come and form the layer, okay. So it forms like this. So this process is what we call it as solvation, or specifically hydration. You know, solvation is a general term and hydration is very specific when the solvent is water. Is it okay? During this process, some amount of energy is released. What do you call that energy? Yes, that is delta H hydration. Okay, delta H hydration. So these two energy terms, one is enthalpy of lattice, that is lattice enthalpy, second is enthalpy of hydration, that is hydration enthalpy, decides whether a solid dissolves in a solution or not, in a solvent or not. How you will understand? We can write delta H lattice plus delta H hydration. Delta H hydration is equal to what? Delta H solution is equal to delta H solution. whether the process takes place or not is decided by these two energy terms, that is delta H lattice and delta H hydration, right? If the energy released is more and than the energy required, it will take that much energy from the energy released and some energy is left, right? Where is that energy? It will be given to the solution. So you will see the solution becomes little hotter, okay? But in other case, that is if the lattice enthalpy is, that is the energy required is more and energy released is less, what happened? It requires some more additional energy. Are you agreeing? From where it will take the energy? It has to take energy from the solution only, right? Once it take energy from the solution, what will happen to the total energy of the solution? It will become less. So you will find the solution is lowering its energy, which you can easily identify by the cooling effect. You will feel once you dissolve that salt, it will be having cooling effect, right? So these are the two things, that is delta H lattice and another is delta H hydration. These two things togetherly decides the enthalpy of a solution, okay? Next we will come to the effect of temperature. What is the effect of temperature? It's common sense, right? Commonly we say salt or sugar or whatever dissolves in hot water much readily. Suppose if you are preparing the same nimbu pani, what you will do? If you want to get it in cold water, what you will do? If you have common sense, first you take normal water, try to dissolve sugar in it, right? After dissolving that, you can add cold water to it. Initially itself you are adding cold water, it take too much time for you to dissolve sugar in that. So normally you take normal water, add sugar, dissolve, then after that you add cold water to it and dilute it to the required amount, isn't it? It is our common sense. Similar to that, if you prepare tea, to that tea, hot tea, you add a sugar, it dissolves very fast because the temperature decides whether a substance dissolves in it very fast or not. So the solubility depends on temperature, right? Next we will see how this temperature is affecting. See, you take the case of a solute, okay? It is dissolved in a solvent, okay? So it is in undissolved state, right? So when this solute is dissolved, it will remain a solute only. But what happened? It is in soluble form. It is in soluble form, right? So when a solute is dissolved in a particular solvent, the solute dissolves in a solvent to form a solution, right? So finally you get a solution where the solute is in soluble form, right? Now during this process, the energy absorbed or released, what you call it as delta H solution, okay? Delta H solution, right? This is about what we discussed. Now this delta H solution, its value, okay, its value, that is if it is less than zero, what is less than zero? Negative, right? That means it is exothermic. It is an exothermic process. One condition. What is the second condition? Delta H solution is greater than zero. What is greater than zero? That is endothermic process. Endothermic process. Now based on this, you tell what is the ideal condition, the temperature. When you dissolve a salt in a particular solvent, it is converted to a solution, right? In that, once the solution forms, the enthalpy of solution is exothermic, that is negative, that means exothermic. It is already giving out heat, right? Think of Le Chatelier principle, what we'll discuss. You know what is Le Chatelier said, right? So if the system is giving out energy, simultaneously you are also trying to increase the energy, what is the net effect? System will try to decrease the temperature. On which side the system can move so as to decrease the temperature means it will try to oppose the change. Is it what we learn, right? So what it happen, it what it do, the system will try to move to that side where it absorbs heat. If you increase the temperature, system try to decrease the temperature by promoting that reaction or that process which absorbs heat. So if it is an exothermic process, is it ideal condition to increase the temperature? No, it is decreasing the temperature is ideal, that is at lower temperature it prefer to dissolve. Agree? And when delta H is greater than 0, that is if it is an endothermic process, that is dissolution, that is moving of solute from solid to liquid state, if that process is an endothermic process, is that an ideal condition? Yes. So what you will do, when you increase the temperature, what happens? The system moves from left hand side to right hand side, that is more and more salt can be dissolved in it. Is it clear? So generally we can say if the enthalpy of solution is less than 0, that is for an exothermic process, if you increase the temperature, the solubility decreases. And the second factor, delta H solution, if it is greater than 0, greater than 0 in the sense, what is it? It is endothermic, right? For an endothermic process, it is heat absorbing process. So if you try to heat it, system try to absorb more and more heat, reduce the temperature, thereby it promotes the forward reaction. That means it ensures more and more amount of solute dissolves in it. Is it okay? Okay. Now, the same thing, for example, I have taken a graph to give you that idea. See, here I have taken solubility, that is the amount of solute that can be soluble in 100 gram of water, and the temperature plotted against it, right? So when we plot it, you can see for almost every solute, say sugar, right, potassium nitrate, sodium nitrate, sodium bromide, potassium bromide, all this, almost everyone, the temperature increases simultaneously. What is also increasing? The solubility is also increasing. This is very quite common, that when we increase the temperature, what happens? The amount of the solute that you added, or the amount of solute that can be dissolved in a particular solvent, amount of solvent is also increasing. Is it clear from this? And there is an exception for it. You can see cerium sulfate. In cerium sulfate, the graph is going down, which indicates that it is which process? It is an exothermic process. Okay. Then what is the effect of pressure? You know, pressure has no effect in solids. So in the dissolution of a solid in a liquid, pressure has no effect. Solubility of a gas in liquid. We are very familiar with so many occasions in our life where gases are dissolved in a liquid. Can you give some examples for it? Any idea? Yeah. Yes, tell. Soft drinks, right? Where carbon dioxide gas is dissolved in soft drinks, right? So here are some examples for it. That is a dissolution of carbon dioxide in soft drinks, right? Then another example is dissolution of oxygen in our blood. Because of that only we are living, right? Then another example, dissolution of oxygen gas in water. Even though its solubility is very less, it is very important. Because of that only the aquatic species survive, right? It is very less only, very less quantity, but that is more than sufficient for the aquatic species to survive. Is it okay? So these are some examples where we come across with the solubility of a gas in a liquid. Now you see this, who is this gentleman? Any idea? No? Okay. He is William Henry. He is William Henry. He is the man who studied detailed about the dissolution of a gas in a liquid. He studied the solubility of a gas in a liquid. And after all, he proposed his findings in the form of a law called a Henry's law. So what Henry's law says? You see, I have taken some liquid in a container and some gas above it. Okay. Now what I am going to do? If I keep it for some time, there will be obviously an equilibrium established. Why? Because you know, the gas molecules above the liquid surface, they come and collide with the liquid on the surface, and this collision permit few gas molecule to go into the liquid phase, right? And this keep on going, that is dissolution, it keep on going for some time, and after some time what happened? Some molecules which already dissolved in the liquid, they will also start coming out. So at a particular time or particular stage, what happened? The number of molecules of gas which comes into the liquid and the number of molecules of gas which comes also out of the liquid, they become almost equal. So what you call these two opposing process, once their rate becomes same, when the number of molecule entering the liquid and the number of gas molecule going out of the liquid, once it become equal, what is that particular state? Right, tell, you know, what is it? It is dynamic equilibrium, right? It is dynamic equilibrium. So it attain a dynamic equilibrium, no doubt in it. Now what I am going to do? I am going to disturb that system. How I am going to disturb the system, you see? I am going to apply pressure. I am going to apply pressure. So once I apply pressure on it, obviously Le Chatelier principle thing, once we try to disturb a system which is already in a state of equilibrium, the system try to readjust itself so as to nullify the effect of change. Understood? You know that, na? So the same thing, I am going to apply pressure on the gas. So once I apply pressure on the gas, the number of gas molecules which comes and hit on the surface of the liquid increase. So obviously the gas pressure, the pressure of the gas above the liquid increase, the system want to decrease the pressure, right? So what it do? It permit more number of gas molecules to come into the liquid, right? Thereby it can decrease the pressure on top. Or in simple words, can I tell, as the number of particles or number of gas molecule comes into the liquid increase, means in simple words what I can tell, the concentration of gas in the liquid increase, right? You look at here, the number of gas molecule inside this liquid increase, or can I tell the solubility of gas increase, right? So it re-establish a new equilibrium, it re-establish this equilibrium. Is it okay? So this is what Henry identified. So based on his observation, Henry proposed the law. What is that law called? Henry's law. So what is Henry's law says? The solubility of a liquid, or sorry, solubility of a gas in a liquid is directly proportional to the partial pressure of the gas present above the surface of the liquid or solution. So what it says? The solubility of a gas in a liquid is directly proportional. Directly proportional means one factor increase, another factor also increase. I mean the pressure increase, solubility increase, right? So if you say C is the concentration of the gas in the liquid, right? It is directly proportional to what? Pressure. So when you increase the pressure, concentration also increases, right? So you can say that what? The solubility of a gas in a liquid is directly proportional to the partial pressure of the gas present above the surface of the liquid. Okay, you know what is partial pressure? It is the pressure exerted by the vapors of that particular component under same conditions. Is it? Now, let us see the other form of Henry's law. How you can state it? The partial reverse, okay, thing reverse. So initially I told I have what? A liquid in which I am dissolving some gas. The amount of the gas that is going to get dissolved in this liquid is directly proportional to pressure that I apply. Okay. Now, think reverse. I have some gas dissolved. It's a solution, right? And I kept it closed. You know, after some time what can happen? These gas molecule try to escape from the liquid. That is, it starts escaping and it starts occupying the space available above that, right? After some time what can happen? Few gas molecules that are on the surface of the liquid start coming back, right? So what is the pressure exerted by this particular vapor? What is that? That is the partial pressure of that, because you can have other gas molecules also mixed along with this vapor, right? So the partial pressure of that particular gas is what? Partial pressure of that particular gas above the liquid is proportional to what? It is proportional to the amount of the gas that is dissolved already in the liquid. Is it? That is another statement. You can see the partial pressure of the gas in vapor phase is proportional to the mole fraction of the gas in the solution. What do you mean by mole fraction? We already discussed it. Mole fraction is the a method to express the concentration, right? So it is the number of moles of that particular component to divided by total number of moles present in the solution. So here you can say the pressure, partial pressure, okay, is directly proportional to mole fraction of that particular component, right? Is it okay? Partial pressure is directly proportional to the mole fraction of that particular component. And here you can see P is proportional to chi. Partial pressure is directly proportional to mole fraction, or you can say P is equal to, I am equating it with a constant called a KH. What is that constant called? It is called Henry's constant. What we call Henry's constant, KH into chi. So it indicates the partial pressure is directly proportional to mole fraction. Now if you plot a graph by taking the partial pressure of the gas and it is plotted against the mole fraction of the gas, then you will get a straight line passing through the origin, because they are directly proportional, right? So it, you will get a straight line which passes through this, passes through the origin. Now if you plot the graph for different gas, you see, for different gases you are plotting, for example helium, nitrogen, oxygen, etc., you will see that for different gases at the solubility varies with pressure. See, O2, it is going up, okay, N2 going up, here also going up, but the extent to which, see, this at this pressure, say you take this pressure, at this pressure the amount of oxygen that dissolves, nitrogen that dissolves and helium that dissolves varies. So from this graph you can see at this, it is plotted at constant temperature, right? So from this graph you can say at this particular pressure who will dissolve more, which is having higher solubility, O2. So the solubility of O2 is very high compared to helium, or other words you can say at a particular temperature the amount of various gases that are dissolved at using a particular pressure will be varying, or other words can I say it is the solubility that is changing. So O2 is more soluble than helium. Is it clear? Is it okay? Clear? Now you know P is equal to KH into chi, or what is KH equal? KH is equal to P by chi, okay, P by chi, that is KH, and is inversely proportional to what? Chi is inversely proportional to chi, or other words you can say if KH is more, chi is less, that is mole fraction is less, or the concentration or the solubility is less. Now think in terms of that, you take helium and hydrogen at same temperature 293 and 293 Kelvin, one is having KH 144 and another is having KH 69. Which is having larger value for KH? Which is having larger value? Yeah, obviously helium, right? 144, other is 69 only. So compared to helium and hydrogen, you compare both this. While comparing, can you tell which is least soluble? Which one is least soluble? The one with low, higher value of Ka, because KH is inversely proportional to chi, right? So you can say helium is less soluble, very less soluble, and hydrogen is more soluble, okay? Now that take the case of nitrogen and oxygen, both at same temperature you take 293, 293. So one is having KH 76, oxygen is having 34, okay? Now tell, nitrogen or oxygen, which is more soluble at 293 Kelvin? Which is more soluble? Oxygen. Clear? That is the reason why oxygen dissolves in our blood more than nitrogen, right? Now again we will look one more factor, that is the effect of temperature. It is very important. You take the oxygen gas itself. Oxygen at 293 Kelvin, the same gas, oxygen at 303 Kelvin. Look at the value of KH. At 293, that is at low temperature, KH is less, right? And at little higher temperature, what is the value of KH? KH is 46.82. That means as the temperature increases, the solubility of gas decreases. What is it? As the temperature increases, solubility of the gas decreases. This is the reason why the seasonal migration of aquatic animal, particularly fishes, do migrate. it preferred to remain in cold region rather than in hot region, because in hot region, as the temperature is high, obviously the amount of oxygen gas dissolved in that water will be less. That is the reason they do migrate to cold region, because in cold region the amount of oxygen dissolved will be more. Is it okay? So it is another very important concept. Now we will look at the applications of Henry's law. It is widely applied. We will just look 2-3 examples. First one is preparation of carbonated drinks. Now you know, if you want to dissolve more amount of carbon dioxide in water, you have to apply more pressure. So that is the reason why when you open, see, have you ever seen opening a carbonated bottle? So once it is closed, it is tight closed, there is already an equilibrium established between dissolved carbon dioxide in the liquid and the carbon dioxide above the liquid, right? The moment you open, the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide gas decreases, right? Whereas the amount of carbon dioxide dissolved in liquid is very high. Obviously, there will be escaping of this dissolved carbon dioxide from liquid to outside. That is what comes out in the form of that bubbles. Okay, so the application, first application is the preparation of a carbonated drinks. Then another one, the mountaineers, when they climb up, they will start suffocating. Why? Because the partial pressure of oxygen at higher altitude is very, very less. So the amount of oxygen that is dissolved in our blood is more, and the partial pressure of oxygen outside is less. So what happens naturally, as we go climb up, the amount of oxygen, since it is more in our blood, it starts to come out. So finally, the person who climbs at higher altitude will find it difficult to breathe, and he lose his conscious, and a particular medical state is arrived. That is what you called anoxia. What do you call anoxia? And to avoid that anoxia also, people carry what? Oxygen cylinders and oxygen mask. You can see this person is wearing an oxygen mask, right? So these are the applications of a Henry's law. Okay children, by this we are going to conclude this session, and we will be discussing about Raoult's law and its further topics in the next session, and I hope you all understood what we have discussed in this session. Thank you. We will meet again soon.